Thank you. Thank you. It's a great honor and a pleasure being here. So thank you for the invitation to this very high-level meeting. When we talk about invasive lung cancer, we immediately think about the T4 variable. That is a very heterogeneous factor speaking about lung cancer staging. Now I will address some of these issues, particularly superior vena cava involvement, carinal reconstructions, invasion of the aorta, the atrium, and the pulmonary artery. And I will address specifically the technical details of this issue, since the philosophical part has been comprehensively addressed by Kit Nonheim in the previous section. So let's start with SVC invasion. This is an historical paper. The first world case described was probably, I would say, but my boss, who is Professor Rich and is the author of this publication, always said that this was the truly first world case. At that time, there were not many Italian surgeons speaking English, so the case was published, was reported in this International Gazette of Medicine and Surgery. That was not international at all, it was a very local publication, but it was interesting. You see the chest X-ray and this complex reconstruction with a Y-shaped graft self-made by the surgeons. And then the activity of our group at that time continued with the different primordial techniques of SVC reconstruction with the saphenous vein, wrapped around a chest drainage with these results. Now, when we talk about SVC involvement, there are two important categories. One is the invasion by the primary tumor, and specifically it's always right upper lobe lung cancer, and then there are patients with SVC invasion by N2 lymph nodes. This is the most interesting part of this type of reconstructions, and in this type surgery should not perform unless there is not a complete response by induction chemotherapy or chemoradiation, and it's going to be a very much more difficult operation. There are different means of reconstructing the superior vena cava with autologous pericardium, with bovine and now porcine pericardium, and there are synthetic materials. As you will see, we prefer this type of material to reconstruct the superior vena cava, since there are no size limits. The edges are stiff enough to keep the sewing easy, and there are virtually no contraindications to the use of this material. From the technical point of view, we have to keep separated patients with an obstructed superior vena cava, and they obviously well tolerate complete clamping of the vessel, from those who has a non-obstructed superior vena cava. And in this subset of patients, clamping of up to 50% of the circumference is usually well tolerated. Otherwise, we have to consider the use of an external shunt of cardiopulmonary bypass. And these patients should be heparinized before clamping, and anticoag should be administered after discharge. This is a patient who required cardiopulmonary bypass, and this is the first patient of our series where we applied an external shunt, and you will recognize first generation thoracic drainage that was used as a shunt with two tourniquets placed at the two edges of the superior vena cava. Patch reconstruction should be performed when only a small part of the SVC circumference is involved by the cancer and autologous pericardium. In these situations, the use of autologous pericardium is advisable and should be quickly fixed in glutaraldehyde to keep it a little more stiff and facilitate stitching. Now, to reconstruct the full circumference of the superior vena cava, we use this technique, rolling bovine or porcine pericardium around 10 millimeters syringe and shaping it with this auto suture. It's easy, fast, and you can follow the suture line at volume rendering CT scan after surgery. We almost never now use this type of grafts. Most of the patients requiring this type of reconstruction have lung cancer, but there is another 35 to 40% of the patients that have thymic tumors, both thymoma and thymic carcinoma. These are serious. Until 2016, there are some more cases added in the last 3 years, 2 years and a half. And obviously, patients with mediastinal tumors do much better than patients with lung cancer, and the operative mortality is acceptable. And for our series, is in line, if not better, than the others reported in the literature, with 38%, and survival is, generally speaking, around 40% overall. The second topic is carinal reconstruction. There are several types of invasion of the carina on the right, on the left, on both sides. And in many cases, carinal reconstruction, since it's related to tumors that are very central, requires also reconstruction of the superior vena cava. Here there is a video that is a little slow to start, but you will see in a minute the interesting part that addresses both carinal reconstruction and reconstruction of the superior vena cava. It's a very bulky tumor that at preoperative staging was N0. So this is the reason why we perform such a reconstruction in this situation. You here appreciate that the main pulmonary artery has been prepared medially to the superior vena cava. The pericardial sac is open, and this here the carinal bifurcation with a tumor arriving at the origin of the right main bronchus. Here, since also the superior vena cava was involved, the conduit to reconstruct it has been prepared. And it's important because you can trim the length after suturing the tube on site. The pneumonectomy on the vascular side is performed in the standard way with vascular suction. I think everybody now do it this way. And then the carinal portion is removed. This is the left main bronchus that is secured with a stitch to avoid the retraction into the contralateral mediastinum, and is intubated through the operatory field. And then the distal trachea is cut, and the specimen is removed. Here you can see inside the airway the double lumen tube that is retracted at the time of the resection of the carina. The last part of the removal of the specimen includes clamping proximal and distal of the superior vena cava with two Satisky clamps. And then the reconstructive part of the procedure is started. This is the tube of bovine pericardium that is first sutured on one side and then on the other side. It is important to keep it under tension to avoid kinking after reperfusion and after closure of the thoracotomy. This is the proximal side, the distal side, and then the two vascular clamps are removed to allow flow after a little de-airing of the vessel. After completing the vascular part of the reconstruction, the airway is subsequently reanastomosed in the standard way. We use separate trio absorbable stitches, and after performing putting the stitches on the whole circumference of the vessel, the tube for contralateral ventilation is removed and the double lumen tube is readvanced towards the left lung. And then the two edges are approximated and the stitches are closed. We usually cover the anastomosis with a flap of intercostal muscle, and the pericardium in this case was closed with bovine pericardium to avoid retraction of the heart. And here is the immediate postoperative control of the anastomosis. We can do, I think I missed a slide. We can do the same procedure on the left side. It's a little more complex, and we usually do it through median sternotomy. And here is the control on that side. Or we can remove only the carina, reanastomosis the two bronchi, and here is the intraoperative control a little after the procedure. Another variation of the reconstruction is removal of the carina with a sleeve lobectomy and reimplantation of the intermediate bronchus on the contralateral left main bronchus. This is extremely useful when feasible to save part of the right lung. This series was up to 2016, 30 patients. Four patients had major complications, and there was a 3% mortality with an overall survival at 5 years of 43%, in line with the major series reported in the literature. The two most important are the one from Tsuchiya and Philippe Dacvel, with a very generous series of patients. Invasion of the aorta has been for a long time considered an absolute contraindication for surgery. Some years ago, some reports started to appear in the literature. I think that the first important series was proposed by Walter Klepetko in Vienna, and it's dedicated to a very selected group of patients, young patients fit for surgery, and zero. And they, up to a couple of years ago, the aorta was reconstructed under cardiopulmonary bypass, either with a patch of Goretex or with a tube of Goretex. And we used to cover it with the omentum while using these prosthetic materials. Some time ago, along with another group in Padova, directed by Federico Rea, that you all know, we developed this technique, stenting from the inside the thoracic aorta with a covered expandable stent that allows safe dissection of the wall of the aorta by scissors. either saving the intima of the vessel or sometimes resecting the full thickness of the wall, and there is no leakage around the vessel. Here the inner layer of the vessel was saved. Also, invasion of the atrium require extended resection of the wall. They are usually associated with reconstruction of the superior vena cava. And here you can see the resection line on the atrium that was performed after dissection of the interatrial groove to put the Satisky clamp as centrally as possible. There are other situations that are more peculiar. Sometimes there is no need to resect part of the atrium, although there is a thrombus that abuts the inside the atrium, like in this case, where after placement, the Satisky clamp very centrally after dissection of the interatrial groove, under the guidance of intraoperative transthoracic echocardiography, we were able to remove the thrombus inside the atrium and suture the inferior pulmonary vein without resecting the wall of the atrium. The last two words are dedicated to the invasion of the main pulmonary artery that is one of the battle horses of our group. Obviously, when we talk about T4, we speak about the invasion of the origin of the main pulmonary artery, and this situation is always on the left side. This type of reconstruction requires cardiopulmonary bypass and is usually performed with a patch reconstruction of the wall of the pulmonary artery. If it's more distal, we can either perform a sleeve resection or a patch reconstruction of the vessel, or we can build a tube of autologous pericardium or bovine pericardium to reestablish the continuity of the vessel. All these situations should be assessed intraoperatively. What looks inoperable before the operation may be operable at the operatory table, and is also through the reverse. Another technical details, sometimes the conduit can be prepared using the upper pulmonary vein that should be prepared intraoperatively, and we use this TA stapler to save as much as possible of the length of the pulmonary vein. It is washed, and you see that it's a very nice cylinder of vein that is viable to reconstruct the continuity of the vessel. And this is extremely useful if resection of the pulmonary vessel is required, but it is not required a sleeve resection of the bronchus. In these situations, the two stumps of the pulmonary artery are sometimes difficult to reapproximate and require the interposition of a vascular tube. And here is the continuity of the pulmonary artery reconstructed with this tube. And the volume rendering CT scan demonstrate the patency and of the vessel without any kinking. I will close with this four or five statements, stressing what Keith Nonine already did in his previous talk. Nodal status is important. These are technically demanding operations that should be done only when the patient can take advantage of these procedures that has an increased risk of morbidity and mortality. So N0 patients should be enrolled in this type of programs and should be performed at high volume centers with strong experience in this field. Thank you very much for the privilege of being here.